Okay, well, welcome back. We are currently doing a verse-by-verse study of the book of Acts. I hope everybody had a great weekend. And let's keep everybody in our prayers. There's people recovering from sickness, some traveling. And so let's keep everybody in our prayers. But we'll go ahead and get started. Let's spend a few moments of silent prayer to confess our sins, to make sure that we are in fellowship, in a place to be taught by God, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit cannot teach us, cannot enable us, or empower us by His Spirit unless we are in fellowship. And we're only in fellowship when we're walking in obedience and have no unconfessed sins in our life. So we all would like to spend a few moments to confess sins so that we can be able to be taught by God the Holy Spirit. So with that being said, let us pray. Father, we're so grateful for another day of your grace. Thank you for your love toward us, demonstrated through the work of your Son, Jesus Christ, on the cross. You sent your Son into the world because you had us personally on your mind. And he had not only came to serve us, but he came to die in our place. And we're so grateful and thankful because there's no other way for us to be saved but through your Son sacrificing his life for us. So we thank you for the work of Christ. And thank you, Father, for giving us your Spirit. Apart from your Spirit, we have no power to live the Christian life. And thank you for the Bible. Without your Bible, the Word of God, we have no divine wisdom. Wisdom comes from you. It comes from your Word. And you preserved your Word so that we may have your wisdom. And we're so grateful for the Bible. Thank you for those who teach your Word and with the spiritual gift that you have given them. And we just pray and ask of you, Lord, as we attempt to understand your word tonight, that God the Holy Spirit will help us understand so that we can be able to apply it to our life. Pray for those who are traveling for safety. Pray for those who are recovering from sickness and surgery, that you are restored in the health so they can continue to pursue your word and your truth and your plan for their lives. Bless our time together as we continue to look at the book of Acts. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. All right, so if you will, open your Bibles this evening to Acts chapter 20. Acts 20, verse 32. Acts 20, verse 32. In our last class last week, we were looking at Paul at Miletus, and as he's on his way to Jerusalem. And he made some pit stops or some stops on the way to Jerusalem. Ultimately, Paul is gonna, he's heading to Jerusalem. And then from Jerusalem, as we will see, he will end up in Rome, which is the capital of the Gentile world. But now he's at Miletus. And while he's there, we saw him get there in verse 15 of chapter 20. While he's there, he sent for the elders of the church of Ephesus, and these elders came over to see him. And as they got there, he began to give them this address and exhorting them. And so he will conclude his address with the elders with a blessing. And so tonight we will look at Paul's conclusion of his address to the elders who came over to Miletus to see him and also to hear the words of encouragement that he had for them. And so we'll start with Paul's conclusion of his address to the elders. And he will conclude this address with a blessing. And we'll start with verse 32 through 38, and then we'll get into chapter 21. So let's start with verse 32 of chapter 20. So, and now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I have coveted no one's silver, gold, or clothes. You yourselves know that these hands ministered to my own needs and to the men who were with me. In everything, I show you that by working hard in this manner, you must help the weak and remember the word of our Lord Jesus, that he himself said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." When he had said these things, he knelt down and prayed with them all, and they began to weep aloud and embrace Paul and repeatedly kiss him, grieving especially over the word which he had spoken, that they would not see his face again, and they were accompanying him to the ship. So we'll start here. So here in verse 32 through 38, for you guys who are just joining us, we're in Acts chapter 20, verse 32 through 38. Paul is finishing up his address to the elders of Ephesus as he stopped in Miletus on his way to Jerusalem. And so in verse 32, here we see Paul demonstrating his faith in God, seeing that he would not be able to build these elders up once he had left, because he don't think that he's going to ever see them again. And so he's going to demonstrate his faith as he commend them in verse 32. He say, "And now I commend you." Now the word commend here simply mean entrusting someone to the care or protection of another. So the person that Paul is entrusting these elders to the care of, not knowing whether he'll even see them again, he's entrusting them to the care and the protection of God and to the word of his grace. So here, Paul is demonstrating his faith, saying that he's about to depart. He may not see these elders again to be able to build them up, but he entrusts them to the care and protection of God. But not only he's entrusting these elders to the protection and the care of God, but he also, and to the word of his grace, and to the word of his grace. He also entrusted these leaders to the word of God's grace. Now this word here, the word of his grace, is a reference to the scripture, the Bible, concerning God's grace. God's grace is a source of all spiritual enablement or spiritual ability. There is no ability apart from God's grace enabling the believer spiritually. So God's grace enable the spiritual growth of these elders. So Paul entrusts these elders to the grace of God. And then he say, another note on grace. Grace is God's ability, not man's ability. And so Paul understands that it is only through God's grace will these leaders have the ability to be able to continue to grow to spiritual maturity. And God's word is able to build up the elders from Ephesus. It is because of this grace that these elders will one day enjoy all the blessing of God's grace, seeing that they're believers. Notice in verse 32, he say, "And to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified." All those who are sanctified is a reference to believers. And so these elders have an inheritance from God's grace, being believers in Jesus Christ. And this inheritance will be realized in the future. The inheritance is the ultimate glorification of believers in Jesus Christ at Christ's second coming. And these elders in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 1 through 4, the elders are encouraged by Peter to be good stewards of what God had entrusted to them. And when Christ comes back, Christ will reward the elders when he returned for being faithful to what he have entrusted to them. The elders is the spiritual leaders within the local church, and they will be rewarded, as Peter say in chapter 5, 1 through 4. That's what this inheritance is. This inheritance is the blessing that will come to believer when Christ come back. If you go to 1 Peter chapter 5, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 1 through 4, Peter mentioned this inheritance or these rewards that Christ will bring with him, and the elders who are been entrusted with the church to provide spiritual leadership to the church will be rewarded when Christ come back. In 1 Peter 5, verse 1 through 4, therefore, I exhort the elders among you as your fellow elder and witness of the suffering of Christ and a partaker also of the glory that is to be revealed. So this glory that is to be revealed is a reference to the future inheritance for those who believe, not just the elder. Verse 2, shepherd the flock of God among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but voluntarily, according to the will of God, and not for gain, but with eagerness, not yet as lording over those who are loaded to your charge, but prove to be example to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. So here we see that the pastors of local church who have been entrusted by God with the flock to provide spiritual leadership, if they are faithful, they will receive a reward when Christ comes back. Going back to Acts, so Paul commend these elders to God in the word of his grace, which is able to build them up and also able to give them their inheritance. And now in verse 33 through 35 of Acts 20, in these verses, we see Paul exhort the elders by reviewing his habits in his lifestyle. Now, Paul is not being prideful by boasting in his habits, but he only is bringing out the habits of his lifestyle to encourage these elders to imitate his lifestyle as they shepherd the flock of God, as they provide spiritual leadership to the local churches. In verse 33, he say, I have coveted no one's silver or gold or clothes. You yourself know that these hands ministered to my own need and to the men who were with me. So Paul here lived an exemplary lifestyle, and these elders is encouraged here by Paul to follow his example. In other words, they are to lead the church as Paul led them. How did Paul lead them? Well, in verse 33, he said, I have coveted no one's silver, gold, or clothes. In other words, Paul did not desire what belonged to others in greed. He was not serving for material reimbursement. You know, most people today in local, elders and pastors today, a lot of them would not serve unless there's a guarantee that they will receive some type of material reimbursement. Paul tells these elders here in verse 33 that I did not serve for material reimbursement. I did not covet no one's silver or gold or clothes. I didn't want material. These are material. Silver, gold, and clothes are material things. So what he's saying, when I was serving, I wasn't desiring the material things of others as a reimbursement for my service. What a great example to pastors and elders and leaders within the local church is when we serve, we're not to be looking for reimbursement for our service. So Paul had a policy here. What was his policy? Paul's policy was not to ask others for support, not to look for a reimbursement for his service. But he said in verse 34, you yourself know that these hands minister to my own need. Paul said, I labored to support myself, but noted that Paul did not only work hard to support himself, but notice what he said, what he did. He said, and to the men who were with me. So Paul raised his own support, but he used the earnings from his hard work to support those who was traveling with him. What a gracious man he was. Paul did not hesitate to raise money for himself and others who were with him. So he looks at the motive that leaders should have. Paul's motive was always to give and not to look to receive. His motive was to serve and not look for anything in return. And these elders, upon Paul's departure, were to Jerusalem, were to follow his example. That's the only reason why he's mentioning his lifestyle is he wanted these elders to follow his example. You know, we live in a time as then where people don't give unless, don't serve unless they know they will receive something back from others who benefit from their service. This is not true grace orientation. This is not true grace orientation. We should give and serve others without looking for anything in return. When we serve others, we're not to have strings attached to while we're serving others, because that's not grace. That's not grace. God is calling all of us as believers, not just these elders, these spiritual leaders, but God is calling all of us to be grace-oriented, to be grace-oriented. And what does that mean? That means that we are to serve without looking for believers to reimburse us for our service. That's what we're called to do. We're called to serve without looking for anything in return. If we look for something in return, this is not true grace orientation. We are to give as servants without looking for anything in return. See, that's the gospel. That's the gospel of Jesus Christ. What is the gospel of Jesus Christ? The word gospel means good news. And what is the good news? The good news is that Jesus Christ gave himself for our benefit, not looking for anything in return. And so what did the Bible say in John 3:16? For God so loved the world that he gave in for God so loved the world in mercy that he gave in grace. See, grace is when you give somebody what they don't deserve without looking for anything in return. See, it's not grace if we have strings attached to our service. It's not grace if strings is attached to our service. God gave us without looking for anything back in return. That's grace. No strings attached to our giving. That's grace. You know, a lot of people, even when they give their offering within the local church, we're not to give looking for anything in return. We realize that God has been gracious to us, and so we give out of what God have already given us freely from his grace, and we give without looking for anything in return. What do being gracious mean? It means freely you receive the good news and the blessing of grace. And now, as a believer, we are to freely give out of ourselves for the benefit of others without looking for anything in return. God is calling us, as well as through Paul, calling us to be grace-oriented, to live exemplary lives. Show believers what it means to be gracious, is that we are to serve without looking for anything in return. When we give with the right motive, we will be blessed, but we don't give to be blessed or to receive a return or a reimbursement. We realize that God shown us grace, and therefore we become gracious as we grow. The more I grow spiritually through learning the word of God, the more I realize how much God have already blessed me. And the more I realize how much God have already blessed me, the more I desire to give out of myself for the benefit of others, because I realize how blessed God have blessed me, and I don't deserve what he have done. And he don't even look for me to give him anything in return, but I freely want to do it because I am so grateful for what God have done for me in grace. In verse 35, go back to Acts 20, verse 35, he say, in everything, I show you that by working hard in this manner, you must help the weak. And remember the words of the Lord Jesus, that he himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And so here, Paul say, in everything I showed you, showed here mean to give you an object lesson. Paul say, my lifestyle of grace orientation or grace giving was a object lesson to you, speaking to the elders. But not only Paul's grace attitude is a object lesson for the leaders he's speaking to from Ephesus, but Paul's life is also a object lesson for us believers today reading this. And what is the lesson? We should always serve without looking for reimbursement, because we realize that God have graced us out, and we just want to reflect the grace of God in everything that we do. The believer working hard here to help others who are in need. That was Paul, working hard to help those who are in need without looking for anything in return. And guess what? God blesses that attitude. He blesses that motive. All right. In verse 36 through 38, here we see Paul is going to depart from Miletus. Starting at verse 36, it says, when he had said these things, he knelt down and prayed with them all, speaking about the elders. And they began to weep aloud and embrace Paul. You know, look at the personal love that these believers, these elders, these leaders had for the Apostle Paul. What made them have such affection and love for Paul? One, how can you not love a man who laid down his life, even though he have health issues, he laid down his life for your benefit? All of us should live in such a way that when we leave this earth, people can sense that we're gone and feel sick in their stomach that we're gone. But there are some people, when they pass away, nobody's going to miss them. But Paul is missed by these elders. And one of the reasons he's missed is the grace orientation. This man always gave out of himself for the benefit of others without looking for anything in return. And so they was very sad. that he was leaving. And one of the main reasons they were sad, because he had told them earlier that I'm not going to see you guys again. And then in verse 38, grieving especially over the word which he had spoken, that they would not see his face again, and they were accompanying him to the ship. So, and then verse 1 of chapter 21, it say, when we had parted, now parted here mean, it speaks of the painful parting of friends. So it was a painful departing. When we had parted from them and had set sail, we ran a straight course to Kos, and the next day to Rhodes. Now, I want to mention something about this island of Kos, C-O-S, I mean, Kos, C-O-S. This island here, which is in the southeastern part of the Aegean Sea, is famous. This island that Paul arrived at here is famous for the temple to Asclepius. Asclepius, if you know Asclepius, I don't know if y'all remember me mentioning, well, you probably, if you didn't attend our church service, you probably don't remember who Asclepius is. He's the god of healing. He's the Greek god of healing. This is like the Kos is the birthplace also of Hippocrates. If you know Hippocrates, he's the father of medicine. And so it also, this island was a major shipping port. And so Paul set sail and he came to Kos, and the next day to Rhodes, and from there to Patara, and having found a ship crossing over, verse 2, to Phoenicia, we went aboard and set sail. When we came in sight of Cyprus, leaving it on the left, we kept sailing to Syria and landed at Tyre, for there the ship was to unload its cargo. And after looking up the disciple, we stayed there 7 days, and they kept telling Paul through the Spirit not to set foot in Jerusalem. So evidently, the Holy Spirit is telling Paul that danger awaits him in Jerusalem. Now, keep in mind that Paul had raised some contributions for the poor believers in Jerusalem. Not only did he work to raise contribution, but when he was traveling on his third missionary journey, he raised a lot of money. And so he actually got money that he wants to take to the poor saints in Jerusalem. But he did have a heart to win the Jewish people. But here the Holy Spirit is telling him not to go, and he's going to almost lose his life by going to Jerusalem, because it's going to be through the Jews' persecution that he's going to end up going to prison and later heading to Rome. I want to make a few points, and then we're going to have to stop, you know, right here. But before we stop, I want to just talk a little bit more about grace orientation. Grace orientation. Because God is calling all of us to be grace oriented in our lifestyle. And I can't help but get this out of my mind. Do y'all know, and anybody can answer this, and I already gave the definition in our study tonight, but when we say grace orientation, could you give me a definition of grace orientation? Grace orientation. What does it mean by grace? What do I mean by grace orientation? In other words, we as believers, as Christians, should always be grace oriented. Grace oriented in our thoughts and also in our action. What does it mean to be grace-oriented? You may have to unmute yourself to respond. What does it mean to be grace-oriented in your life? What does it mean to be grace-oriented? All right, I'll give you the answer if nobody wants to answer. Being grace-oriented means to reflect God's grace in your life as you deal with other people. To reflect God's grace in your lifestyle at all times, because you realize the grace that was shown to you. I show you what I mean. Go to Romans chapter 12. In Romans 12, we're told that we should never take our own revenge when someone is wrong enough. When someone wrong us, we're never to take our revenge. Let me show you what grace orientation means from this verse. A little bit there, sorry. Romans 12, let's look at verse 17 through 21. Romans 12, 17 through 21. And we're looking at what it means to be grace-oriented or having grace orientation. All right, verse 17 say, never pay back evil for evil to anyone. So never take revenge. So if I seek revenge when someone wronged me, I'm not being grace-oriented. I'm not reflecting God's grace when I retaliate to a wrong that was done to me. It says, respect what is right in the sight of all men. If possible, verse 18, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. Never take your own revenge, beloved, but leave room for the wrath of God. In other words, I am not to fight my battles, but I am to show grace and kindness to those who wrong me and allow God to fight my battle or deal with those individuals. But I'm not going to harm that individual in my words or action, because that would not be grace orientation. Grace is when I give someone something that they don't deserve, even if they don't apologize. I'm going to forgive them. I'm going to show them kindness, even if they don't apologize or make right the wrong they have done to me. That's grace orientation. I realize that God has given me many blessings that I don't deserve. So I'm gonna be kind to that individual because I want to reflect the grace that God showed me. And then verse 20 say, but if your enemy is hungry, feed him. And if he is thirsty, give him a drink. For in so doing, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. So when I do good towards someone, no matter who they are, even if they have done me wrong, that's grace orientation. That's you're showing them in that individual grace. You're reflecting the grace that God shown you. Also, the Bible say that God sent his rain on the evil and the good. In other words, he blesses everybody. He blesses everybody. That is what grace orientation means. Be a blessing to everybody, even if they have nothing to give you back in return. Don't look for reimbursement when you do something good for somebody, or that would not be grace orientation. So Paul is our example of always giving for the benefit of others without looking for anything in return. All right, we're going to stop a little early tonight. Got a few things I got to get taken care of. And thank y'all for joining in tonight. And I encourage you to look for opportunity to be gracious to those who may not deserve you being gracious to. All right, let's close in prayer. Father, we're so grateful for the grace you have shown us. Thank you also for influencing the Apostle Paul so that he can be an example to all leaders, including me, and how he always gave for the benefit of those whom traveled with him and other believers, like the believers who were poor and need and sick in Jerusalem. He raised contribution for them. He even worked in his own business so that he could be able to have to give to those who are in need. And he never looked for anything in return because he sought to reflect the grace of God. Help us as well to imitate Paul's life, Jesus' life, so that we also can be examples of what grace looked like in a believer's life. Keep our minds and heart until we meet again. In Christ's name, amen. All right, y'all have a good night. God bless you.